Hola, mis amigos. I'm coming at you today from a few miles north of the Mexican border at Oregon Pipe National Monument in the very southern portion of Arizona. I'm spending the night at the Twin Peaks Campground here inside the park, and I'm gonna give you a tour and let you know what I think. So if you wanna find out all that, stick around. All right, so I've just arrived here at Oregon Pipe National Monument at the Twin Peaks Campground and have not set up yet. So let's take a quick peek at my site here. So here's my first glance at this particular site. Site number 203, in case you're interested. So what do you say? Let's start this off by checking out some of the amenities that you get at a typical campsite here. Now probably the most important thing is, where are you gonna lay your head at night? And here is where we set up our tent. So the tent pad was advertised being 12 feet by 11 feet. I actually measured it with my measuring tape, and it's close. It was 11 feet in that direction. It's actually about 12 and a half feet going that direction. So a little bit larger than advertised, but I have a very small tent. My tent is approximately, I'd say about 7 feet by 4 feet, something like that. So you can see plenty of room to spare for me. So you can see the tent pad is consisted of gravel, very much the same gravel that's outside of the tent pad. A little rough, I wouldn't call that soft by any means, but not bad. The site is extremely level. All of the sites here that I looked at are very level, so that's always a very nice thing. Don't have to worry about sleeping on any hills in this campground. Granted, out here in the desert, for miles and miles, it's pretty darn flat. So it's not hard to mess that one up. Now, as for staking in here, very nice and firm. The stakes went in really easily. I only had problems with one of them, one over here, where I hit a rock or something really hard and it wasn't budging. So normally you don't have that problem inside tent pads, but for the most part, everything is battened down really good, ready for some high winds. So rather than a ground fire, you're gonna have these stand-up grills. They are adjustable. I was able to move the grill up and down, so that's a plus. Got a little place here to set stuff, but I'm not a big fan of this here. That is very rusty. You see all that rust on there? I don't know how safe that is to cook on, to be honest. I've heard that if you eat something that had touched rust, something rusty, that you can get lockjaw. I don't know if that's actually true or a myth. If you know that, leave a comment down below. I'm actually genuinely curious to get some dialogue around that. Would you guys cook on a rusty grill? I guess let's phrase it that way. So it's pretty clear. I've looked at the neighboring four sites. Situation's the same thing with the grills, all very rusty. All right, this was kind of wigging me out a little bit. So I decided to test out my cellular coverage and do some research on rusty grills on the internet, which brings me to my next point. I actually got pretty good service. I had 2 to 3 bars of LTE coverage out here with Verizon, here at least in my site, in site 203. So I was able to find out, I didn't really do extensive research, but the first thing I saw said that if the rust is loose and you eat it continuously and cook on it, it can cause problems to your intestinal tract. I still want to hear from you guys about your thoughts on that, but there you go. So standing at my campsite, if I turn around this way, you can see I have very easy access to trash cans and recycling. So the thing that sold me on site 203 might be obvious to you. It's the shaded ramada here. Now compare that with the neighboring site. They don't have a shaded ramada. Most of them don't. There's one over there that does, but I would say only a few have that. So if you're looking to book a site, keep an eye out for that. Even though the ramada is not a standard amenity and very few sites have it, what I can tell you is every site has a picnic table. Mine happens to be primarily made of wood. Looks pretty freshly painted. A lot of the other ones though are made of metal, so it's kind of a mixed bag as to what you're gonna get. So here's a nice little map you get when you come into the campground. You can see overall, I'll zoom out here. That's the whole campground. Now the gist of it is most of these are RV sites, all of the color-coded ones that you see there. Now where I'm at are these gray sites here at the very end of the campground. I'm actually site 203, so you could see me right there. I mentioned earlier that there's some space between myself and the next campground. You could see, you can kind of visually tell that there's a few like that here. The ones that are close together are definitely close together. But overall, that's kind of a layout. So sites 113 through 174, 113 through 174, those do not allow generators, which is nice for us tent campers, so we don't have to hear that racket. So I picked a campsite that's very centrally located here on this loop, and if I turn around, check this out. Water spigot is right there with drinkable water. Now I ran this thing here, and everything works perfectly, and the water gets really cold actually. So let it run for a couple seconds, and ooh, very refreshing. Now one thing I noticed is there's a trail that kind of goes around the campground also. There's my campsite. So I've got really nice access to some trails. I think one of these goes to the visitor center, which we'll be taking a hike on here shortly. So what we have here is the Oregon Pipe Cactus. This is what the National Monument Park is named after. This guy. Now, did you know that this is the only place in the United States, this region, this small region of Arizona, where these things grow? I think they're more commonly found in Mexico. So if you ever want to see these guys in the wild, you gotta come here. So over here, we're on the outer edge of the campground. There are no more sites beyond that way. So I chose my spot, for example, site 203, based on knowing that, just to try to eliminate too much noise and stuff. You can see this is another inner row. So they're gonna be surrounded by people on both sides and going on and on like that. Here's a look at another one, site 205. The folks have not yet arrived. So let's go sneak a peek. So 205 is on the outermost edge of the loop, like my site. This one does not have any kind of shade. And your standard stuff, this tent pad is a little bit more well-defined and exposed. More square than some of the other ones, but not a bad site. A lot of great views facing, I'm assuming that's south towards Mexico. So one thing I'm already noticing here in the tent section, there's not much variance in how the sites are laid out. You have a really small driveway, tent pad, picnic table, just kind of a clearing there, out in some desert brush. So, I mean, nothing really that fancy. So site 189 is the first of the tent sites that has something a little different about it. Right off the bat, you can see you've got your tent pad. It's one of the more elongated ones. But what you do get over here is I like the way they kind of set back the table and the grill a little bit off here against this desert brush and these trees. So you really get a lot of great privacy on this side. However, that does come at a slight cost, because if I turn around this way, you've got another campsite right there with no obstructed sight lines. So privacy is really bad. And here's your site 190, one of the larger size tent pads, your picnic table and grill. But once again, 189's right there. And then you got folks right over here. So a little crowded. So this is site 200. Another one of the sites where there's lots of extra growth, Palo Verde trees here, pretty much obscuring your view of your neighbors completely on that side. And even though you're pretty close to folks here, a lot of nice growth on this one too. So this one's not too bad. Once again, that's site 200, and that's a huge tent pad compared to some of the other ones I've seen. So if you're looking for a spot that accommodates a pretty large tent here, site 200 will treat you well. So overall, I mean, you get the gist of it already, at least in the tent section. You just have rows and then site, all pretty equally spaced out. Some of them are a little bit further detached from each other than others, but for the most part, not the most interesting layout. It's economical, it's practical, but not the most creative campground you're ever gonna visit here. 183 is like mine, where you get one of these little shaded ramadas. And I like this. This one's got shade actually from this tree. So you got a Palo Verde here, shading where your tent's gonna be. You got this shaded ramada, and nice privacy on pretty much either side. Beautiful Oregon Pipe Cactus, and Another one over there. You got the RV rows kind of starting right behind here. But overall, I like this one. So here's an example of an RV site. This is site 168, very close to the tent only loop. It borders it. These only accommodate RVs 30 feet to 35 feet. So you can see pretty nice sized driveway here. Now, if you are camping in a tent, I don't know if these also allow for tents. They might, but if they do, you really don't get much choice where you're gonna put up a tent that's not gonna fit one very well. Pretty small little area back here perhaps, but not really good for tents. So all of the RV sites here bordering the tent camping only section are pretty much the same thing. Same driveway length that I've seen so far anyway. No electric hookups, no water, but there you have it. There's also a sign when you come in here that indicates that the max vehicle length is 40 feet. But don't let that trick you. Not all the sites will accommodate a 40-foot RV. I think these go up to 35 feet, between 30 and 35 feet. So they do have different sites that accommodate different size RVs. So you can see I'm not too terribly far away from where the restrooms are. There are paths that intersect these rows that go straight to the restroom with plenty of signage. So yeah, this is not that inconvenient actually, not bad at all. Here is one of the restrooms here. Very clean. Nicer than I thought it was going to be. Pretty much got all your basics in here, pretty small. You also have a utility sink right over here where you can wash dishes. Back at the rear of the campground, right behind where the tent only section is the dump station. So you can see you got some drinking water here, trash cans, you got your waste disposal here. They do have a few accessible sites here. This one, you can accommodate an RV 25 to 28 feet. Someone's already set up here, but you can see the entire thing is paved. And this building over here is a restroom, but it also is supposed to have showers. Solar powered showers, in fact. And a quick look. This is your solar powered shower. Very clean. You got a bench in there too. Looks like it's accessible also. I'm running it right now, and I would call that pretty cool. I wouldn't say it's cold. Ah, there it goes. It's starting to heat up actually. So yeah, it's nice and warm right now. So one piece of advice for you, you probably don't want to take a shower in there early in the morning, because since that's solar powered, relies on the sun to heat that water up. And I've heard a couple stories of people doing that, and that's a wake up call. And the more towards the front we go, the more thick it becomes with RVs. So this is site 82. This is one of the ones that's supposed to accommodate an RV up to 40 feet. And I could tell the driveway is definitely a little bit longer than the rest of them for sure. So there's a vacant site where you can get up to a, I guess, a Class A in there. And I'm kind of in the heart of the campground now, kind of right smack dab in the middle. This road in the 80s where you can get the larger sized vehicles in seems to be right in the middle. And this is site 67, so you could see it starts to get smaller again. RV's up to 28 foot here. So a few little facts about the campground here. There are just a little bit over 200 sites total, some of them of course being tent only, the majority of them being RVs of varying sizes. Everything's very clearly marked as to what size can be accommodated per site. The largest that I've seen, there's only three of them, can accommodate up to 45 foot RVs, and then you've got a smaller selection that accommodate up to 40 feet and then lower from there. And a little note about generator hours for those sites that allow you to run one. So there's where you enter the campground. There's a ranger in there, and that's where you'll check in when you arrive. So I've decided to take the Campground Perimeter Trail. It's about a mile, 0.9 miles, all the way around the campground in a loop. So this could be a good place to get a little jog in the morning. It looks like it's pet friendly. No bicycles allowed though, however. So the campground's right over there, and I'm starting to get away from it. And look at how much more lush this is. How many more organ pipe cacti there are back over here. Probably a sign of some things to come. I've also noticed a lot of designated pet areas around the campgrounds. This place does appear to be pretty pet friendly. I think I might spy an amphitheater down there. I see a big white screen, which usually is a sign of that. And I'm standing on the perimeter trail looking at the rear side of the campground, the tent only section, and the front is straight back that way. So you can see the perimeter trail does not veer far off from the campground itself. You're always close to it. All right, so I am back at my campsite. I have cut through the entire campground. I've explored everything I think there is to see in the campground. I think the next thing that I wanna do is I wanna take another trail that goes to the visitor center so we can kind of get a look at the desert, maybe see some more organ pipe cacti, and then check out the visitor center itself and learn a little bit about the area. So here at Organ Pipe, as well as some other national park units around the state, they have this thing, this promotion, I think it's called Hike for Health. And if you hike a certain number of miles, now it does differ from park to park, but here if you hike 5 miles, for example, total, and you can prove it through pictures that you take at various locations to kind of prove to them that you hike the trails, you'll get a little nifty pin. So I am on the hunt for that here. The Palo Verde Trail is 1.3 miles between the campground and the visitor center. My assumption is walking back and forth counts as 2.6 miles, for example. So I'm gonna just use my cell phone and record little video snippets saying, hey, I'm here, I'm in the middle of the trail, whatever. And hopefully that serves as enough proof that I'll get the pin. Look at that sea of cacti in front of me. It's beautiful. You could see them as far as the eye can see all the way up to the mountains, and they just fade off in the distance. Those are a mixture of saguaro cacti, the really big ones with the arms, the more iconic ones, and then a mixture, of course, of these organ pipes. So, very beautiful. Not gonna lie to you, this is a good little hike through here. I mean, it's an enjoyable hike, but it's a little long. I mean, it's like I said, it's over a mile one way. Just bring water, for sure. I stocked up at the campsite, but be careful out here. So there you have it. This is Highway 85 right out there. And right down the road, Sonora, Mexico, 7 miles. So we are very close to the Mexican border. And here we are at the visitor center at the entrance to this section of the park. Pretty big visitor center, actually. This little monument is in honor of Chris Eggle, who was a ranger slain in the line of duty. So there was some illegal activity out of Mexico here, and he was shot here in the park, trying to protect the park and the visitors. All right, let's go check this place out. Nice little museum in here. A lot of information about the flora and fauna. They also have a gift store here. A lot of really cool t-shirts, actually. I really like these a lot. And they have a lot of different styles too. These are $22.99. Some educational books in here, even more t-shirts. I mean, I don't think I've seen this selection of t-shirts anywhere. I love those. Those might be my favorite ones so far. Very retro looking. All right, so there you have it. That was the visitor center. Pretty small museum, but got some good information in it. Little gift shop. They don't really have supplies. I didn't see food or ice or anything like that. So if you're camping here, you probably want to come prepared. There aren't towns too far from here, but you're probably better off just stocking up. I also confirmed with the ranger how the whole getting the pin thing works. Yes, the trip to and from the campground counts. So the trail is 1.3 miles long. So going back and forth is 2.6 miles, and absolutely that counts towards the 5 miles. So it should be pretty easy to get that pin. It's always kind of a bummer when you can't make a ground fire, isn't it? I'm just doing a charcoal thing tonight. I'm gonna cook up a couple bratwursts that I brought. I'm not gonna use the grill, as we saw earlier. It's pretty rusty. Gonna use some pokers. Just kind of hold my brats there in the flames. That is a beautiful scene out there in the desert. The sun has disappeared behind the mountains now, And the sky is just very calm and pink. Looking off towards Mexico. All right, so I have settled in for the night. It's probably about 7:45 p.m. and I am exhausted. I hiked all day long. I hiked miles today. I need to get back in shape. I'm let things go too long now. But yeah, I'm gonna just chill because I have an early morning of more hiking. Thought I'd bring you into my little zone here and show you what it's like. I'm just charging some batteries. I've got my charge station going. Gotta recharge all the batteries so I can keep filming. That's part of the routine that we do here. And I'm gonna just read for a while and take it easy, and then maybe check some social media stuff, chill out, and then hopefully fall asleep pretty soon. My only big concern right now is I drank a lot of Gatorade and water, and I'm hoping I don't have to pee anytime soon because I'm very comfortable and I don't want to have to get up and put my shoes on and go through the rigmarole of doing that. It's part of the life, man, part of the life. All right, the time has come, the sad time, where I have to head back to civilization. Before I do though, let me share a couple thoughts about the Twin Peaks Campground with you. I mean, overall, I had a pretty pleasant stay. Really enjoyed my time in the park, but I'm gonna be honest, this campground could use a little bit of TLC. Best example that I have, the grills. They've definitely seen their use by date and then some. It's time to update that, guys. And then the other curiosity would be, like, why don't you guys have more shade here? We're really exposed. I think this place would be a lot more enjoyable if more sites had ramadas like that. The other thing is, very cookie cutter layout kind of campground. If you've seen one campsite, you've probably seen them all. There's very little variance. Some of them are a lot closer together than I would like. I lucked out, mine was pretty private and I didn't have neighbors last night, which helped, but it is a little bit crowded. Now on the positive side, the perimeter trail that goes around the campground is awesome, and it hooks up with some other really awesome trails. So if you stay here at the campground, you have really easy access to some of the awesome hiking trails in the area. In addition to that, you have some other cool amenities, the solar showers, you do have flushing toilets. That stuff is awesome because, yeah, that makes life a lot easier when you're camping. So overall, I mean, I enjoyed staying here. All I'm saying is this place could use a little bit of TLC. All right, so the last order of business I have before I pack up my campsite is I have to go into the visitor center there and claim the pin that I should have earned for hiking over 5 miles here in the park during my stay. All right, I was successful. It's my second one. Bam, look at that. I'll show you a little bit closer up in the car. There it is. Oregon Pipe Cactus National Monument. I hiked the Green Desert. Oh yes, I did. So if you want to claim one of these little beauties for yourself, it's not too hard to do. 5 miles isn't that far to walk. I hiked 3 different trails here, so I did well over 5 miles. Just take a picture at the trailheads. They're very casual about it. You don't have to be scientific about it. I always go a little bit overboard and they stop me halfway through and say, you're good to go, and hand it over. Besides, all the evidence is on YouTube, so you know I didn't cheat the system. But yeah, you just do that. You go in there, show them a couple pictures, and they will give you this. It's definitely well worth it. If you enjoyed this episode, please like, share, and subscribe, and check us out on social media at Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And if you want to camp at the Twin Peaks Campground and want even more information, head on over to cactusatlas.com. We'll put a link in the description down below. Till next time.